You want to?
Of such things in the world as 535 miles of shells. I kept trying mentally to figure out, well, if they're 10 shells high, and how many, and I forgot all about having rows of shells. I was thinking about round the walls and how big the place would have to be.
You wondered where they were.
Well, listen, it's good to have you all back, although I see a lot of empty chairs.
They're on their way back.
We got a lot ahead of us in the next few weeks. And incidentally, yours and Trent's letter to Jim Wright warmed the cockles of my heart. That was just great. And your statement also there.
Thank you.
I don't imagine that too many of you would have been surprised back in January if you'd known then that we'd be meeting here today on September 15th with the budget process once again in critical condition. As far as our priorities are concerned, let me state again the importance of funding national defense and our security assistance program. These areas of the budget have been cut sharply over the last 2 years, as we all know. And of course, some in the Congress would like to rewrite Graham Hud-Rudman in such a way that further cut defense or try to force a tax increase. And that cannot and will not happen. You know, they also oppose giving me the tools I need to control spending through the budget process. As far as the budget appropriations are concerned, we've simply got to demonstrate our ability to stick together during the tough days ahead. If we're going to be serious about setting limits on spending, then now's the time to do so. And if we're united against raising taxes, then I believe we'll prevail in the end. And I think the people will remember us for that. I spoke once before to many of you in this room about looking at some of the problems. Sure, we're outnumbered. We're the minority. But there are two things that come with every one of these problems. One, okay, we may be outnumbered. We may not be able to win on that. But if we stick together, we may also then have gained a strong political point for the campaign coming ahead. That we can point the finger at them, and we can't do it if we split up and go in several different directions ourselves. But to start our discussion, I'd like first to hear from Bob Michael and then Pete Domenici as to where things stand. So you're on.
Yeah, thank you, Sam. Well, number one.
President of Senegal.
Yes. Well, Mr. President.
That's about all the French I can ask.
Vous en connaissez plus que moi. Content de vous voir.
Well, I'm happy to see you. We prize our relationship with your country very, very highly. And congratulations on the African Prize, your latest honorary degree.
Joined up.
have Ambassador Walker, sir.
For a place to be here. Very, very, very good. Very good. Right, can you say that?
The Minister of Foreign Affairs of Senegal, Mr. President.
Hello there. Nice to see you.
Okay. Now we're going to bring our...
self-sufficiency in these regions, even though it may not have banished hunger altogether. But in Africa, the new technologies of the Green Revolution, characterized by high input and high energy farming methodologies, have singularly been lacking in Africa. The tragic events of the Great Drought and Famine of 1983-86 have dramatically exposed the fragile foundation on which Africa's food farming policies and practices rests. That foundation cannot sustain a food production system that demands of it higher yields on the same land that is rain-fed, worked upon by resource-poor farming communities, dependent on a traditional knowledge base which took it for granted that each plot of cultivated land would be rested for several years in each 10-year cycle. After 80 years of attempting to implement a temperate-type agriculture in a tropical environment, trying to replace a mixed farming system paralleling the genetically diverse tropical climates with a monocrop agriculture, and making a heroic effort to ensure that Africa's enormous range of staples conforms to the staples like wheat, rice, and potato of Europe, North America, and Asia, it has become transparently clear that the challenge of tropical Africa to the scientist and the statesman is profound and long-range.
Excuse me,
John Holmes.
Oh, yes.
Hello there.
Mr. President, I'm very, very honored.
I'm honored to meet you, and I have a little one of my guests, Valerie.
Our friend.
I think she's very fond of you.
She's very fond of you, Mr. President.
I know, and I'm sure the doctor knows what you all are doing here. And let me just add that, yes, we want to participate and help and believe in through economic growth and private enterprise and so forth, that we can resolve this problem. We want to be a part of it.
Well, I congratulate you on your leadership for your own initiative. It's been an inspiration to the entire international development community. So thank you for the White House initiative on ending hunger in sub-Saharan Africa.
We
want to
be of help.
It shows.
Okay.
We've been covered a lot, so it's hard to keep track here.
In no way I was awarded a doctor of science, and also made an honorary fellow of the academy.
So we're honoring the right people in leadership, I think, Mr. President.
Yes.
From the pleasure of commanding this message, we certainly can.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President, we want to express our thanks for your taking the time to really be with the leaders. And I know you would be with President Duke in your camp. It really, really helps the cause of your own kind of stand for the end of hunger. And I want to thank you very, very much for that leadership and that time.
It was a pleasure. We value our relationship with your country very, very highly.
Thank you very much.
And I tried to draft him for one of our basketball
teams. I was going to say, Mr. President, that's exactly right. Exactly right. We were talking earlier about his stature as a president, and we meant that both ways, I guess.
Well, very good to see you.
We look for a partnership.
Thank you for all your work.
Thank you for what you're doing.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. President.
We're very proud in our country of private citizens that form organizations and so forth to be of help and outside the bounds of government.
I feel I'm following your lead. Thank you for that.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Again.
This is Archbishop Patrick Flores.
Thank you for welcoming us. Good to be with you.
Good to have you here.
Ernest Robles.
Thank you very much
for your support.
August Bush.
Present. Oh, yeah. Nice to see you again.
It's good to see you.
With
your
usual.
Feel good.
Thank you.
This is Jesse Aguirre.
Mr. President. It's an
honor. Ricardo Nunez.
Hello. Hello. From Minnesota. How are you?
Just fine.
Paul Cedeo.
What is he off? We got him from Miami. Well, nice to see you.
Oh, I lost
this
here.
Is Paul Cedeo.
Paul Cedeo.
Nice to meet you.
Right.
Nice to see you again. Like from California.
Yes. Gilbert Chavez.
All right. Mr. President, I think I'll move the easel in the center, then we'll have everybody group around it for the presentation. Okay. Well, we have some of you on both sides here to balance it off.
Let's see.
Okay, you wanna,
what do you guys think?
So you want to kind of hang it back.
Well,
are we ready?
Mr.
President, on behalf of the National Hispanic Scholarship Fund, Anheuser-Busch was asked to prepare this poster to thank you for your support of this most worthy cause. And we thank you from both the fund and from our company.
Well, listen, I want to thank all of you for what you're doing. I think this is remarkable. 11 years, 6,000 students so far, and it's, we all know the importance of education without my attending to it. I just think this is so wonderful of all of you to be engaged in this. Appreciate it.
We thank you for welcoming us. And this is the support that we needed. We've got it now, so we promise to keep on going.
All right.
For the glory of the country and the people of the nation. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. President.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you.